ladies and gentlemen. He's a child of God, a husband, NRA conservative, radical right-wing supervillain, and Twitter rock star. American by birth, Texan by choice, and a badass by nature. He's the owner of TomOHalloran.com, OHalloranMedia.com, and PatriotRadio.net. Please welcome Tom O'Halloran.
And good morning, America. Welcome to the Patriot Radio Show. I'm your host, Tom O'Halloran. And I'm broadcasting today from my underground bunker deep in Arkansas, Brascarado. I'm here to educate, irritate, and agitate, with a special focus on agitation today. Again, my name's Tom O'Halloran. My primary blog, TomOHalloran.com. Purely a coincidence, I assure you. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/Patriot Radio Show. Personally, I'm at facebook.com/O'Halloran. And folks, we do this show five times a week. So if you're not watching five times a week, you've got to ask yourself, what could you possibly be missing? Tune in 9 a.m. Texas time, Monday through Thursday, for this, the Patriot Radio Show. On Fridays, we do Jihad on America. Here we cover the Islamists in America, sharing with you who they are, what they want, and why you should be afraid. If you've not heard my show on the Muslim Brotherhood, my show Islam is Not a Religion, or my show on Islamophobia, then please find your way to PatriotRadioShow.com. Listen to all three of these shows for insight and perspective on the Islamic topic that you've probably not heard elsewhere. The shows will also give you a solid foundation upon which we build each and every Friday as we continue to pull back the mask of Islam, looking at what's being done in the name of Allah, both here and abroad. And I do the news about Islam around the world because it's a glimpse into the future of what's in store for us here in America if we continue to allow the cancer of Islam to spread here in the homeland. Keep abreast of my shows, listen to the live streams, as well as catch up on the archives of any shows you may have missed, all at PatriotRadioShow.com. By the way, there are now 452 episodes on hand. The show is also rebroadcast daily at conservativeradiobroadcasting.com, at the conservativeradionetwork.com, at Liberty Works Radio Network, and at rednationrising.us. You can also take all 452 shows on the road with you with your iPhone or Android just by downloading the TuneIn app and doing a search for the Patriot Radio Show. And with that, we're going to go straight to the phones, bring in my pal, the deplorable Mike Nelson. Mike, you with me, brother?
Irredeemably deplorable, and the Russians are coming.
That, it's all right. Sarah came on the air just the other night. She tweeted out, "Don't worry about the Russians. I can keep an eye on them from here." She was trolling the liberals. Oh, it was too funny. I can keep an eye
on them. Digging them.
Yep. What a mess. I mean, everywhere you looked yesterday, the Russians were being blamed for everything. The bad weather in the Game 7 of the World Series. I saw
the Democrats didn't seem to have much problem with them when Hillary stole them all that uranium, right?
Right. I saw a meme on Facebook yesterday with some 2-year-old scribbled all over the walls, right? Like all 2-year-olds do. Oh, and his little sister. Mom opens the door and looks at him. The kid's saying, "The Russians did it." So everybody's blaming Russia for everything just to mock the crybaby left. Now, here's the thing, and I want to get this out of the way at the top of this whole conversation, because we're going to talk about this a lot today, folks. First off, we have been spying on the Russians and hacking into the Russian systems for decades. The Russians
and vice versa.
And vice versa. And the Russians have been hacking and spying on us for decades. This is what it's been about. We have actually tried to interfere in foreign elections for decades. In 2011, when Putin was reelected, Hillary Clinton, and this could be at the crux of this whole thing, Hillary Clinton actually stuck her nose in to the Russian elections and said that it was a rigged election.
Now, the Russian reset.
This pissed off Putin, okay? This was in 2011. This was after the reset button was supposedly pushed. She said it was rigged. Now, that claim by the United States Secretary of State gave license to all the protesters in Russia to go out and protest the election. This pissed off Putin. The U.S. interference in his sovereign elections. So this could just be him, if he was actually doing it, it would be justifiable because she's already done it to him.
Well, if he knows the American people, he probably figured out that, we've had a sick and tired of the way things were going and we wanted Trump. All he had to do was sit back and watch and wait.
Yeah, exactly. And there's no indication, and we're going to go over this again and again and again over these next several stories, but there's no indication at all that the Russians were involved in this. But if they were, it would be understandable because we've already stuck our nose into their elections. Not only that, but Obama spent, what was it, $30 million he spent, I believe, trying to change the outcome in Israel, betting on, I forget what party it was that was running against Netanyahu and failed. But we've already spent our money trying to overturn foreign elections. Kennedy, way back in John F. Kennedy's day, he was asking the Russians to step in and help offset the election.
Well, it's like Bill was saying earlier, you tell a lie long enough and people will start to believe it, you know. But we were meddling in the Southeast Asia elections, you know, before Vietnam. I think maybe we even had something to do with the assassination of one of their president of Vietnam or whatever. It's been a long time. I can't remember the details, but I seem to remember that.
We have had our hands in the untimely death of several world leaders. Several, and it usually led to a worse government than the one we were trying to upset. But what would the consequences be of allowing undue Russian influence on our elections? I mean, if Trump were to allow this to happen, would we give up our plans for missile defense? Would we make deep unilateral cuts in our nuclear arsenal in exchange for flimsy concessions? Would we
tell Tom, if you think about it, Putin sitting back looking at us going down the liberal road to socialism,
right,
a bunch of namby-pambies, no threat to him.
He has already made the United States his bitch for the last 8 years. For the last 8 years, Obama has kowtowed to Putin. He's had his way. He has completely done whatever he wanted. He's taken over Crimea. Obama says, well, that's not right, but we're not going to do anything about it. Go ahead. Everything he's wanted, we've already allowed him to do.
Obama pulls out his saber, draws a line in the sand. You better not cross that line. They cross the line. he steps back, puts another line in the sand. You better not cross that line.
Right.
They cross the line.
Now, the last thing that Putin wanted, and the liberals are all saying that he interfered to get Trump elected. The last thing that Putin wanted was a president that is appointing generals to his cabinet. A secretary of state that goes by the name Mad Dog Mattis. Are you kidding me? That's not what Putin wanted. He wanted Hillary. He wanted somebody that he could bend over and have his way with. This is the last thing that Putin would have wanted. A strong, powerful president that's going to appoint leaders, real men of men. This is not the outcome that Putin would have wanted. Not in any way, shape, or form. The whole Russian hacking thing is totally bogus. And I want to go over a great column I found online this morning, and I didn't get the website that I pulled this off of. I do my first harvest each morning at Breitbart, so it's a good chance that it came off of that. But 10 ways that the CIA Russian hacking story is just left-wing fake news. We're going to go through this real quick. I'm not going to even read the single paragraph after each one, but just the bold headlines. One, there is no actual new information leading the CIA to its conclusion. The New York Times reports the CIA's conclusion does not appear to be the product of any specific new intelligence. Two, the evidence that the CIA has garnered is inconclusive. Even the FBI disagrees that there is any evidence that points to the Russians having hacked anything. Three, the CIA is not making public claims. Here's the thing. We have a former CIA official, saying that there is an unnamed secret source with a secret document. So we have an unverifiable person that doesn't even have a job right now saying that there is an unverified person that has this classified report. There is nobody that we can put on a stand. This is a classic frigging straw man thing. I know a guy that knows a guy that said that somebody did this. How can you disprove this? It's impossible to disprove. Four, despite left-wing news, there is no evidence that Russian hackers actually distorted the voting process. There have been three recounts started. Now, two of them have been stopped because of no evidence of a reason to do a recount. But there has been no evidence whatsoever that the Russians have been involved in hacking voter machines. And this is an important thing here. Mike, if there was any evidence that the Russians hacked a voting machine, you and I would be the first ones screaming on air that we've got to stop using machines, that we've got to seal the machines if we're going to use them. They've got to have no access to Wi-Fi or any kind of remote access.
That's right.
It has to be a sealed system. But nobody is even claiming that the Russians hacked these machines. The left is all out there with the smoke and mirrors and pointing in one direction while the left hand does something else. They're using these double straw man things. All that is being claimed is that the Russians hacked into Hillary Clinton's emails, the DNC's emails, and the Clinton Foundation's emails. They're claiming,
and then provided them to WikiLeaks, and he leaked them out.
Right. Now.
But the thing is, all this angst about who did the hacking and who did the leaking, when the real story is the corruption that the leaked emails exposed. That's being, pounded down a rat hole. Nobody's even looking at that. With the corruption that it exposed.
That's exactly the point. All of this stuff about the Russians, they make it sound like the Russians have hacked and put their thumb on the scale, putting more votes over to this side. If it was the Russians at all, and there's been no proof that it's the Russians, it just sounds more ominous. It gives us an entity that we're comfortable with hating, because they've always been our enemy. It gives us something that we can get our heads around. Oh, we don't want Russians being involved, so that's got to be a bad thing. Julian Assange himself has said it was not a hack. All of these email leaks were leaks from insiders. We know who it was in the Clinton Foundation. It was one of their IT guys. We don't specifically know who it was on the others, but it's WikiLeaks. It's not WikiHacks.
There was a Patriot in the flock.
Yes. All of these people, maybe not even, well, yeah, Patriot. Maybe not a conservative. Maybe it was a Democrat that just hates to see it when Hillary Clinton gets leaked information about the upcoming questions at a debate. It's people that hate to see corruption in the DNC that is stealing a campaign away from Bernie Sanders and all of his supporters. These are leaks from insiders that are being leaked to WikiLeaks, who broadcast it and makes this information known. Stop being.
Yeah, where's the call for investigations about the
actual data.
Primary, you know, being rigged?
Right.
Where are the calls for that hearings?
Where is the call for information about the data that was leaked? That's what is important. The data that it was leaked has not been called into question. Not once has Hillary Clinton said, all of these emails from John Podesta, all of these emails where we called the Catholics and we called the regular American voters deplorables and scumbags. When we called the Mexicans the Taco Bell contingent. All of this stuff was real emails that the left, the DNC, the Democratic Party, the Clinton Foundation talking about how we can milk foreign money into our campaigns. The data
in the chat room, Bill says that Seth Rich was the guy that did the leaking, and he committed a Clinton suicide or something like that.
Yes, this was pretty much a conclusive thing. Seth Rich was one of the leakers, and he was found dead because of it. You don't leak on the Clintons, get found out, and still survive. But the Russians had nothing to do with it. Even if they were the source of the leak, perhaps some date down the road, and it's not going to happen. Obama's making a big thing. I want an answer out of the CIA by January 20th. Come on. Government investigations move at the pace of a glacier. Nothing is going to be discovered in the next 30 days. It's not going to happen. But even
they're just flinging mud, Tom.
That's all it is.
To see if anything sticks. They're desperate. They're insane. You know, the left is never crazier than when they are out of power.
Oh, yeah. Oh, and it's going nuts right now. Just before we went live, Carol, I believe it was in the chat room, threw out a link. Oh, it got shuffled down.
Oh, the dildos and the protest for self-defense?
No. This was the... CNN. Here it is. CNN calls the impending Trump presidency a national emergency. And they're wondering, will Obama declare one? A national emergency because somebody other than us has won an election. And we know it's got to be fraud because we're good at fraud and they still won. So they must have used more fraud than we used.
It can't be our ideology, it can't be our agenda, it has to be something else, right?
The only reason the left won this election is because people inside the DNC, people inside the Clinton Foundation, people inside the White House leaked what the people around them have been saying and doing. WikiLeaks informed Americans how corrupt the Clinton Foundation, the DNC, how corrupt Hillary is. And the American people have had enough. That's all it is. If at some point in time it's found that Russians provided the funding needed to pay these leakers to leak the information, so what? So what? It was real data that was leaked. WikiLeaks informed the American people because the media refused to do so. And if we have to rely on the Russians, I don't care if it's Pravda or what, if we have to rely on Russians to inform the American people, then I'll take it. I'll take it. There's been absolutely zero proof that the Russians had anything to do with this. And we're going to continue going through this list of 10 things because there is so much to cover on the lack of evidence of the Russians' involvement. We're going to pick up right there when we come back. Please stick around, my friends. It is the Patriot Radio Show on a Tuesday morning. We're on the phone with my good pal, the deplorable Mike Nelson. Stick around. We'll be right back. Shout out to my buddy on the road, Richard, my little pal, Charlie. Hopefully to land in Florida sometime today.
Friends, it's certainly true that when you smoke, you want smoothness, mildness, and deep down enjoyment. And that's precisely what you'll get with every Lucky Strike you light, because there's never a rough puff in a Lucky. Just think of that, friends. Luckies are always smooth, mild, and mellow every puff of the way. For you see, it takes fine tobacco to make a fine cigarette. And LSMFT, Lucky Strike, means fine tobacco. Now, fine tobacco costs more, and Luckies pay more. That's right, Luckies pay millions of dollars more than official parity prices to get ripe, mellow tobacco for your Lucky Strike. Just listen for a moment to what the tobacco experts say about the kind of leaf Lucky Strike buys. Take Mr. L. Garland Griffin, a tobacco auctioneer from Clarksville, Virginia, who recently said, "All in all, I've sold over 100 million pounds of tobacco. And season after season, I've seen Lucky Strike buy fine tobacco. Prime, ripe leaf. The kind of tobacco for downright good smoking. I've smoked Lucky's regularly for 14 years. Now there's a tip for you, friends, from a man who really knows tobacco. So for your own deep-down smoking enjoyment, light up a Lucky. You'll agree with the tobacco experts, with the millions who choose Lucky's for a finer, milder, smoother smoke. Yes, puff after puff, pack after pack. There's never a rough puff in a Lucky. Good reason to make your next carton Lucky. Friends, it's certainly true that when you smoke, you want smoothness, mildness, and deep-down enjoyment. And that's precisely what you'll get with every Lucky Strike you light, because there's never a rough puff in a Lucky. Just think of that, friends. Luckies are always smooth, mild, and mellow every puff of the way. For you see, it takes fine tobacco to make a fine cigarette, and LSMFT, Lucky Strike, means fine tobacco. Now, fine tobacco costs more, and Luckies pay more. That's right, Luckies pay millions of dollars more than official parity prices to get ripe, mellow tobacco for your Lucky Strike. Just listen for a moment to what the tobacco experts say about the kind of leaf Lucky Strike buys. Take Mr. L. Garland Griffin, a tobacco auctioneer from Clarksville, Virginia, who recently said, "All in all, I've sold over 100 million pounds of tobacco. And season after season, I've seen Lucky Strike buy fine tobacco. Prime, ripe leaf. The kind of tobacco for downright good smoking. I've smoked Lucky's regularly for 14 years. Now there's a tip for you, friends, from a man who really knows tobacco. So for your own deep-down smoking enjoyment, light up a Lucky. You'll agree with the tobacco experts, with the millions who choose Lucky's for a finer, milder, smoother smoke. Yes, puff after puff, pack after pack. There's never a rough puff in a Lucky. Good reason to make your next carton Lucky's."
Hello, everybody, hello. Halo is the shampoo that glorifies your hair. So hello, everybody, halo. With softer, lively curls and brighter, sparkling hair. So hello, everybody, halo. Halo shampoo, halo. Halo, everybody. everybody, halo. Halo is the shampoo that glorifies your hair. So halo, everybody, halo. For softer, lively curls and brighter, sparkling hair. So halo, everybody, halo. Halo shampoo, halo.
Tom O'Halloran, holding the line against tyranny from Washington, D.C.
And we are back. It is the Patriot Radio Show on a Tuesday morning. And we're still on the air with my good friend, the deplorable, the irredeemable, Mike Nelson. Now, Mike, I really had a great, great show lined up for today, despite you being on. I just want everybody to know that...
I'm going to have to say a little prayer against you for that
one.
It was
circumstances beyond my control that turned it into what it is, okay? The show was hacked by the Russians. Okay.
I got a whole hutch full of rabbits here.
Yeah. Okay, we were going through a list of reasons why the Russian thing is just pure BS. Number six, we kind of said, we're at number five. The Obama administration has a history of manipulating intelligence for political gain. So they're claiming to have this CIA report. They won't share it. They won't tell us who wrote it.
The politicized CIA report.
Right, right. And that's what we're going to come to right here is the most underreported scandal of the Obama presidency was a CENTCOM scandal, in which it emerged that the senior CENTCOM leaders manipulated intelligence assessments. This was in 2014 and 15 to make it appear that President Obama was winning the war against the Islamic State. There's even more reason to doubt the truth of a selective leak about the election. This guy manipulates intelligence, well, because he has no natural intelligence, I guess. Six, we've covered this, not in sequence, but Julian Assange and WikiLeaks have vigorously denied that the Russians were involved in the WikiLeaks disclosures. Again, reiterating, I don't care who disclosed the information. If it wasn't a hack from a foreign government into a voting machine, I'm cool with it. Anybody wants to hack information that our leaders are doing?
Yeah, if they want to expose the corruption in our government, hey, I'm all for it.
Then I'm down with it. I don't care if it's Edward Snowden, the Russians, or the Martians. If they're exposing government corruption, I'm down with it.
But let's do something about the corruption.
Exactly.
And forget where the information came from. That's low priority. But the corruption is what we ought to be focusing on and having hearings about.
And not once did anybody on the left say those emails are fictitious. They've been edited. They've been manipulated.
Well, they couldn't deny that they were true.
Right. Number seven, the fact that the Russians might constantly be trying to hack the U.S. systems and might even specifically have targeted the election doesn't prove that they've succeeded. Nor does it prove that they tipped the election to Trump if they had any effect at all. As Frank Luntz, the pollster, the leftist, by the way, he's a liberal pollster, as he tweeted out, did Russia also hack Hillary's campaign calendar and delete all her stops in rural Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, and Michigan? Hillary Clinton lost the elections for entirely her own reasons.
Yeah, that and the Benghazi millstone around her neck.
Yeah, I mean,
certainly didn't help.
For all of those things. Number 8, foreign interference in elections is nothing new. Okay, we talked about this in the late 1984. The late Ted Kennedy actually asked for Soviet help. Russian efforts to intervene would be bad, but not unique, either for Russia or the U.S. Let's see, Benjamin Netanyahu. The State Department gave $300,000 to a pro-peace Israeli group. This was under Obama. This pro-peace group then paid political activists whose goal it was to unseat Netanyahu. Number 9, let's see, what would the consequences be? Yeah, would we tolerate a Russian land invasion of a friendly pro-Western country like Crimea? Would we cede the Middle East to a Russian hegemony? Oh, that's right. Hillary Clinton, Obama already did all that.
Well, when it comes to the Crimea, most of the people there were Russians anyway.
Exactly.
Now, the rest of the country isn't.
Exactly. It was a land grab.
But he hasn't gone past the Crimea.
And you know what? I respect him for doing it. He said he was going to do it, and he did it.
Well, the people of Crimea wanted to go to Russia.
That's right. And Putin
said... Didn't they hold some kind of referendum or something?
Yep. And Putin said he was going to do it, and he stood by his word, and he did it. No, it comes down to the bullet point number 10, Occam's razor. The simplest explanation for the Russian hacking story is that it is fake news that suits the left-wing media. It's not unknown for Russians to use false propaganda to affect public opinion in foreign countries, nor is it...
How ironic that they scream and yell about fake news while putting fake news out.
Exactly. In fact, the fake news is probably the biggest fake news story of the year. Nor is it unknown for the U.S. media to use bias, fake news, and outright lies to shift public opinion in this country. The current focus on Russian hacking is based on no new evidence, and again, zero evidence, with the tampering of the voting process. This is all we need to investigate as far as the election goes. Election-wise, was there tampering with the election process, the voting process? If the machines weren't tampered with, then move the hell on. Investigate the data in the leaked emails. Investigate the pay for play that was leaked to the voters, so the voters now know that Hillary Clinton actually took money and Bill Clinton took money to make decisions through the Secretary of State's office. Investigate the data that was leaked and forget who actually leaked it, because nobody really cares. Oh, let's see. Sore loser Obama turns Russian hacking to delegitimize Trump's again. I mean, it's story after story after story. This is all people are talking about. A former U.S. Army intelligence officer states the CIA director John Brennan is playing political games. Retired Army intelligence officer Tony Schaefer alleged on Monday that CIA director John Brennan is playing political games via a secret CIA assessment, stating that Russia interfered with the election to support Donald Trump. There is no evidence of this ever happening. Brennan is a CIA appointee of Obama, and he's just paying his dues. Obama says, I need a report, and boom, you get a report. In August, CIA Director Michael Morell also backed the secret CIA assessment of the Kremlin-backed interference in the election. But let's not forget, Morell also endorsed Secretary of State Hillary Clinton for the election, and he stated that that Donald Trump is not qualified for the job. So we've got people appointed by Obama that supported Hillary Clinton, claiming exactly what Obama once claimed. So I think it's understandable why the voters in America are laughing at the left, my friend. They're laughing at the left. They're laughing at the media. Every time somebody says the Russians did it, another half dozen memes are being created, blaming everything in the world on Russians.
That reminds me, I better get to work and make some memes.
Yeah, I've got some notes I've scratched over the last several days, and I'll be doing a little bit of that myself here in the next couple of days. Meanwhile, let's shift off of this and get at least one story that's non-Russian off before we go to the break.
I just posted one on the chat.
Yeah? What do you got?
Wow, the MSN, the Slate columnist, Michelle Goldberg, she was talking about the Trump victory tour, thank you tour.
Oh, yeah.
Rallies are menacing and threatening to the majority of people who didn't vote for Trump.
But it wasn't...
Yeah, how
it
menacing, was, like cow, you know?
Hey, it wasn't a majority of citizens that voted for Hillary.
Was it Trump voters who pulled people out of cars and beat the snot out of them in the middle of an intersection? I think not, baby puppy.
Right. And then we've got the New York Times hiring a fake journalist to cover Trump White House. The New York Times.
Like she's going to get a pass to the press corps.
Right.
No way.
Well, the New York Times has actually hired Glenn Thrush. Glenn Thrush is the journalist that WikiLeaks showed emailed John Podesta. He emailed John Podesta and he said, please don't tell or share this with anyone. Tell me if I screwed anything up in this story. He said,
have Podesta proofread it for you.
He says,
you flack.
He says, not just a flack, he says, since I've become a hack, I will send you the whole section that pertains to you. So he's
he even condemns himself.
He's doing a story on John Podesta, and he
says, is this guy going to come to the White House wanting to get in on briefings and press?
I'm thinking he's the best New York Times can come up with. He's a hack. In his own words, since I've become a hack, I'm going to send you the whole section that relates to you.
Why in the heck would they even allow him in the room? When he shows up for a press conference, tell him to beat it.
Don't
even let him in.
I'm thinking they may. I've got a feeling Trump will be a little bit discriminating on who he allows in. He already doesn't have much respect for the press to begin with. But when you get to people that admit to being hacks, who have been proven to be cheats.
He either has the choice of not ever calling on him, or if he does, bring out the fact that you just mentioned right now about him calling himself a hack.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And he won't be raising his
call
hand.
I'll call on the hack from the New York Times.
Yeah, there you go. Make him wear it. Make him wear it.
Exactly. All right, stick around, my friends. We will be right back, and we'll have a lot more to cover. We've moved off for the Russians, and we've got a handful of stories to cover before this hour is over.
Yeah, we got a good show going.
It's the Patriot Radio Show on a Tuesday morning. A good show in spite of the Russian hack. Stick around.
Winston tastes good like a cigarette should. Winston tastes good like a cigarette should. Winston gives you real flavor, full rich tobacco flavor. Winston's easy drawing too. The filter lets the flavor through. Winston tastes good. like a cigarette should.
Folks, the biggest show in town is opening tomorrow at your Nash dealers. Now, you may think you've seen everything, but wait until you see your first new Nash 600. Sure, it's beautiful, but it's not just a new model. It's a new kind of car. So new, so different, you'll just have to see it to believe it. Think of it, 25 to 30 miles on a gallon of gasoline at moderate highway speed. And it's big, plenty of headroom, leg room, and elbow room for six large people to lounge at ease. And it has a weather-eye conditioned air system and a convertible bed, coil springing on all four wheels. But words can't describe the new Nash cars. You've just got to see them to appreciate them. They're terrific performers, and so much smoother, so much quieter, so much easier to drive. But don't let other folks try to tell you what they're like. See the new Nash 600 and the Nash Ambassador yourself tomorrow at your Nash dealers. They're there right now waiting for you. One look, and you'll know why we say you'll be ahead with Nash.
Hey, but wheat is so good to eat, yes, we have it every day. We sing this song, it will make us strong, and it takes the job, hooray! It's good for growing babies and grown-ups too, to eat. For all the family's breakfast, you can see cream of wheat.
Well, Oscar Otto, the loquacious limousine, and in top form.
Sure, Arlo, and it's because I'm equipped with an Autolite electrical system.
Ah, then you must have an Autolite starting motor, generator, battery, coil distributor, and a set of Autolite spark plugs, plus all the other important parts that go to make up the complete Autolite electrical system used as original equipment on many leading makes of our finest cars, trucks, and tractors.
Oh, you bet I do, Arlo.
That means every unit and component part of your Autolite electrical system is related by Autolite engineering design and manufacturing skill to give the smoothest performance money can buy.
That's why my owner always insists on Autolite original factory parts.
And friends, you'll find it pays to insist on Autolite original factory parts for your Autolite equipped car. Because from bumper to tail light, you're always right with Autolite.
Never borrow money needlessly, just when you must. Borrowed and where loans are a specialty from folks you trust. Borrow confidently from HFC.
Household Finance Corporation offices are listed in your telephone book.
Mr. Clean gets rid of dirt and grime and grease in just a minute.
Mr. Clean will clean your whole house and everything that's in it.
Floors, doors, walls, halls, white sidewall tires, and old golf balls.
Sinks, stoves, bathtubs, he'll do. He'll even help clean laundry, too.
Mr. Clean gets rid of dirt and grime and grease in just a minute.
Mr. Clean will clean your whole house and everything that's in it.
Can he clean a kitchen sink?
Quicker than a wink.
Can he clean a window sash?
Faster than a flash.
Can he clean a dirty mirror?
He'll make it brighter, clearer.
Can he clean a diamond ring?
Mr. Clean cleans anything.
Mr. Clean gets rid of dirt and grime and grease in just a minute. Mr. Clean will clean your whole house and everything that's in it. Mr. Clean, Mr. Clean, Mr. Clean.
Budweiser commercial featuring the Crew Cut.
Where there's life, there's fun. At a concert or a show, in your own backyard, wherever you go. Budweiser beer is for folks to know. Where there's life, there's fun. Budweiser.
Tom O'Halloran, holding the line against tyranny from Washington, D.C.
I am America, one voice united.
And we are back. It's the Patriot Radio Show on a Tuesday morning. We're on the air with my pal, the deplorable, the irredeemable, the one and only Mike Nelson.
That's right. Irredeemable. So irredeemable, God can't even redeem me.
Right.
Now that's crossing the line, my friend.
Right. I want to talk about some of Trump's appointees today. We've seen some possible appointees flying by our news feeds over the last few weeks. But it looks like Mitt Romney is definitely out.
Thank God.
We were all uncomfortable with that. Roger Stone tweeted out late last night or early this morning that he was only being interviewed so that Trump could torment him by taking it away.
Oh God, I hope that's
true. I wonder how long it will take Mitt Romney to get the taste of Donald Trump's butt out of his mouth. Because you know,
well, I'm thinking of a certain line from the movie Walking Dead that Negan told. Maybe the guys out there and that watch the show know exactly what I'm talking about. And he thanked me for it.
And he thanked me for it. I can imagine. But I've complained over the recent weeks about a couple of people. Well, first off, let's stay on Secretary of State. It was taken away from Mitt Romney. It's going to the Exxon CEO, Rex Tillerman. A top corporate executive. I've got no problems with this. Like I didn't with Mitt Romney on his business background, on his being a good person. I mean, Mitt Romney raised a nice family like Trump did. He's got a lot of redeeming qualities. We hate him because of what he did to Trump. But as a person...
Well,
I
got to stick my finger down my throat on that one.
Yeah.
But go ahead.
Well... As a business person, Mitt Romney had a lot of good qualities. Rex Tillerman, again, one of the largest, if not the largest corporation in the world, hugely successful CEO. For him to come out and take over state, he knows the region, he's worked with most of the countries in the Middle East. It's a big thing, and I think it's a great move. I would have liked to have seen one of the... Trump's favorite generals move into that spot, but I like this move. One of the ones that I had a problem with was labor. Oh, before we get this one out of the way, just released this morning, it's going to be Secretary of Energy Rick Perry, former three-term, the longest-serving governor in the state of Texas, will be the...
I saw that this morning on Fox and Friends.
Yeah.
And they were saying that he had vowed to do away with the Department of Energy when he was running.
Well, technically he didn't. He was listing.
Really?
He was listing some departments that he wanted to do away with. He couldn't remember the name of energy.
Oh yeah, I remember that now.
So energy,
somebody had to help him.
Energy was the one he couldn't remember. So technically, he didn't vow to do away with it. But on the other hand,
if he heads it, he can basically neuter it if he wants.
Exactly. He could, or he could use it as a leadership position to spearhead a lot of things that we do need to get done. Rick Perry is a oil man. He's from Texas, so he's got to be pro-oil. He's actually on the board of directors for the corporation. I don't remember the name of it, A&E or something. On the board of the company that's putting the pipeline through Dakotas. It's being protested by all these Indians up there. So he's already in the energy industry, and it'll be powerful having a Texas oil man in charge of energy. I mean, what a switch from this green energy bullshit from the Obama administration. The left is just going to piss themselves. They will be peeing their pants all week long over this Rick Perry appointment. Blood's going to come out of their eyes. I'm just loving Rick. I had hoped Sarah Palin for energy because she was, you know, doing some oil stuff up in Alaska. I had seen Sarah for energy and Rick Perry for labor, but I like this a lot. I like this a lot. Now, I was unhappy with Andrew Puzder for labor. Andrew Puzder is a CEO of a fast food restaurant chain, or several. He's a holding company for several fast food restaurants. I believe he owns Carl's Jr.'s and a couple of other fast food chains. He has long been in favor of hiring Hispanics, i.e. illegal aliens.
Oh, yeah, I seem to recall that now.
Now, that's the same attitude I've had for the last several days, or maybe a week now, that they've been floating his name out there. But listen to this, and I can respect this, because I've said the same thing about Donald Trump and his ties. Donald Trump has ties made in China. He builds towers using steel that's made in China.
And yet, you know, I don't care whether they hire Hispanics, as long as they're here legally.
Okay, and that's one thing. But here's the thing. When you're in business, it's your job to make money and maximize the profit. The sole objective of any corporation is to make money for the stockholders. It isn't to be loyal to your employees.
Well, that's a side benefit.
You don't owe you don't owe your employees loyalty. You owe them a paycheck. You don't owe the country of America the loyalty of keeping jobs here. You don't owe your customers the loyalty of providing the best possible price. You owe it to the stockholders who have given you their money. You owe it to them to provide the best possible return on their money. And as I
said, but going down this road, it kind of flushes patriotism down the toilet. You know, when you're running a company and you have stockholders that are Americans, I mean, there comes a point when, you know, you have to have some patriotism, some allegiance to your country to some degree in even doing business.
Again,
you know,
again, a bell for you, my friend, because you've hit it on the head. And that's where the patriotism kicks in. You eventually come around to the point where you have to elect an American that wants to fix things in America for Americans.
Exactly.
Because it's not the business person's job to drive patriotism. It's the people that we send to D.C. So now we've got a president who's going to fix America. He's bringing in this man. And I've always said, look, Donald Trump builds towers. He uses steel from where he can get the best deal on steel. I can't blame him. Why would I want to buy steel from a company in America that has to pay $85 an hour for somebody to sweep the floor when he can get it from China a lot cheaper? Okay, his job as president is to fix that stuff. Well, here's the Labor Secretary nominee. This is his statement on Friday. And I totally, 100%, it's exactly what I've been saying about Trump for the last year and a half. My job as a business person is to maximize profits for my company, employees, and shareholders. My job as Secretary of Labor, if confirmed, is to serve the U.S. citizen workers. That is my moral and constitutional duty. The public spoke loud and clear in this election and delivered a mandate to protect American workers. It makes no economic sense to spend trillions on welfare and jobless benefits for out-of-work Americans while bringing in foreign workers to fill jobs in their place. As Secretary of Labor, I will fiercely defend the American workers and implement my piece of a 10-point plan that President-elect has laid out. President-elect Trump's plan to establish new immigration controls will boost wages and ensure that open jobs are offered to an American worker first. Hire American and buy American is our policy, and one supported by voters in both parties. I will not provide guest workers visas to companies that break the rules. I will support reforms to raise wages for Americans. I know the system from inside, and I will best champion American workers. I will be the best champion American workers have had. So I respect this. I totally agree. His mission as a CEO is completely different from what it will be as being Secretary of Labor. And as long as he gets this, and as long as he and Donald Trump are on the same page, and by God, Donald Trump knows how to fire the guy the day he gets off message. So
I'll tell you, I'm going to trust Donald Trump to do the right thing and set, like he says, make America great again. I'm willing to trust him on that, and the people he picks, you know, give the guy a chance. And 4 years from now, we'll see whether American people are better off than they were the 8 years of Obama.
Yep, and this guy was one of two that I've not been happy with. Every other pick he's made, I've either been ecstatic over or happy with. From the education to a couple of Secretary of State undersecretaries to SecDef, absolutely love that one. The only other one that I'm not real comfortable with is Secretary of Treasury, bringing him out of Goldman Sachs. But again, like I've been saying from the beginning, like you just reiterated, I back Trump because I trust Trump. If he's picked this guy out of Goldman Sachs, only he knows exactly why he's done it. And I'm going to trust him. I'm going to expect him to do what we need to have done. And if this is the guy that he wants, he's got to have his team. I used to be an IT director, brother. I ran healthcare, or I ran the entire computer network for a large hospital network. 4 hospitals and 23 outlying clinics. If somebody upstairs from me had tried to tell me who I could hire to be on my team, I would have resigned. I did it on a couple of smaller jobs where HR tried to tell me who to hire, and I walked away. I'm responsible for getting the job done, and damn it, I'm going to hire the people that I know will carry out my mission with my best interest in heart, have the loyalty to me to do what I need to have done. And I'm going to give Trump the same free rein, right?
Yep.
All right. Now we have one bit of good news. Democratic Republican Chaka Fatah, an obvious Muslim out of Philadelphia, just got 10 years in prison for fraud, racketeering, and money laundering. He took a $1 million loan to run for mayor of Philadelphia. His wife is a news anchor, and they make about $500,000 annually, and yet they've been skimming money out of the NASA. I don't know how they had access to NASA, but they used federal grant money from NASA to pay back part of a $1 million loan, and they've been intermingling funds for decades now. So one more Democrat in prison. God bless America. Meanwhile, out of Salt Lake City, we're at the top of the hour, but out of Salt Lake City, a prosecutor wants the DOJ to investigate a possible Harry Reid connection to a suspected $2 million bribe. Money from an offshore gaming organization was deposited into a bank in Utah, withdrawn, deposited into an offshore bank account, transferred to Switzerland, and back to another offshore account that has ties to Harry Reid. So that's a great thing. Brother, final thoughts. We're down to the final. What have you got?
Well, I'm thinking that there's a lot being made about these handful, or one in particular, of these electors balking at voting for Trump, you know, on the 19th.
Yeah.
It's going to go off without a hitch. Maybe this one guy might abstain from voting, but Donald Trump is going to be the next president of the United States, and he's going to do a hell of a job.
Yep, and I think Donald Trump ought to invest some of his billions and buy some Preparation H, mail it out to every Democrat in the country, because these guys are...
Oh, you bet. And let's give them the suppositories.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
None of that cream stuff. Right. You got to jam it in, you know what I mean?
Or we could send it to them, the cream in a great big deal. I don't even want to go down that road.
Oh, that's just those story again, huh?
I don't
you can use them
down.
To cram them in with,
this
right?
This show has just lost all credibility. God bless.
Yes.
God bless you and yours, America. Brother, I appreciate you more than I can say.
Hey, what about my rabbits here?
Your rabbits. Cook them up.
Great show today, Tom.
Make stew. Yourself as well, brother. God bless you. This is Tom O'Halloran and Mike Nelson. God bless you and yours, America. We are so out of here.